السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله
صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ والتجأ إليكم يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون واذكر ربك في نفسك تضرعا وخفية ودون الجهر من القول ودون الجهر من القول ولا تكن من الغافلين
So in your gathering with remembrance upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad As a gift to the soul of Sayyidina wa Mawlana al-Imam al-Husayn and his son, al-Imam Zainul Abideen Ali ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali, recite the second salawat. For Allah to shower onto this gathering with His infinite mercy and compassion and for the reappearance of Sayyidina wa Mawlana sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman, Recite the third salawat with the loudest of your voices. The 204th verse from the 7th chapter of the Holy Quran, Surah Al-A'raf, speaks of the etiquette of dealing with the Quran and our encounter with the Holy Book. And of course, this ayah of Surah Al-A'raf is amongst many other ayat that speak of the etiquette of embracing the Holy Quran. Allah And one ayah speaks of how the Qur'an is ought to be carried and understood. لَا يَمَسُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَحَّرُونَ Shall not touch it or understand it unless with purity. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the best time to engage with the Qur'an. أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِدُلُوكِ الشَّمْسِ إِلَىٰ غَسَقِ اللَّيْلِ وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ إِنَّ قُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا Indeed, the best of times to engage with the Qur'an is the time of Fajr. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly commands Rasulullah and he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلِ O you Muzzammil, قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قليلا نصفه أو انقص منه قليلا أو زد عليه ورتل القرآن الله سبحانه وتعالى tells him يا رسول الله this is how you ought to recite the Quran in the middle of the night as you are the muzammil with the beautiful recitation of tartil الله سبحانه وتعالى and another ayah speaks of the etiquette of reciting the Holy Quran. وَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانَ الرَّجِيمِ And if you were to recite the Quran, to engage with the Quran, then seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against the great Satan. This ayah of Surah Al-A'raf similarly speaks of a different etiquette when dealing with the holy book, the etiquette of reading, reciting, the etiquette of listening, and the etiquette of implementing the Holy Quran. The ayah says, وَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنَ And if the Quran were to be recited, فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ Then listen to it. وَأَنْصِتُوا Pay attention to it. What is the result? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ So that you shall receive mercy. Similarly, سيدنا ومولانا ومقتدانا أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب When approached by one of his great companions by the name of Hammam, Hammam comes to him He says, يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ صِفْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ كَأَنِّي أَرَاهُمْ Describe me the righteous or the muttaqeen so as if I can see them with my bare eyes. أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ begins to describe the muttaqeen until he reaches the relationship with the Qur'an. One cannot receive the status of taqwa and piety and righteousness, the nearness, to the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without a special bond, a special relationship with the Holy Quran. So when he reaches their description of their special relationship with the Quran, he states, وَأَمَّا اللَّيْلَ فَصَافُونَ أَقْدَامَهُمْ يُرَتِّلُونَ لِأَجْزَاءِ الْقُرْآنِ تَرْتِيلًا And if it were the night, then they stand firmly on their feet and they recite sections of the Quran in the form of tartil with a beautiful voice. A time where you don't just spend time in close proximity with the Quran. Some of us, we spend time in close proximity with the Quran. But this is a time where we spend quality time with the Qur'an. One-on-one. There is no one else. Everyone's asleep. It's a special time where we dedicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our beloved. Allah says to Musa, Ya Musa, كَذَبَ مَنْ زَعَمَ أَنَّهُ يُحِبُّنِي Are untruthful those who claim they love me. وَإِذَا جَنَّ اللَّيْلِ نَامَ عَنِّي And if the night comes, then he sleeps and he forgets me. And he does not wish to spend some quality time with me. So the first Amir al-Mu'mineen says, at night they stand firmly on their feet, reciting sections of the Qur'an in tartil. But do they only read the Qur'an? Do they only recite the Qur'an? No. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, فَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِآيَةٍ فِيهَا تَخْوِيفٍ أَصْغَوْا إِلَيْهَا مَسَامِعَ قُلُوبِهِمْ فَكَأَنَّمَا زَفِيرَ جَهَنَّمْ فِي أُصُولِ آذَانِهِمْ. Allahu Akbar. Look at the description. He says, if they receive an ayah that speaks of the punishment of Allah, of the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they listen to it, they observe it, not with their ears, but they listen to it with their hearts. And it's as if they can hear the roars of Jahannam in their ears. Then he says, وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِآيَةٍ فِيهَا تَشْوِيقٍ أَصْغَوْا إِلَيْهَا طَمَعًا وَشَوْقًا وَجَعَلُوهَا نُصُبَ أَعْيُنِهِمْ. And if they receive an ayah, they come across an ayah that speaks of Jannah, that speaks of the mercy and the compassion of Allah, that speaks of forgiveness, they listen to it with the utmost greed. Yes? They listen to it with the utmost greed that we want to be amongst them. We want to receive this thawab. We want to be in this position. Excuse me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أقم الصلاة, establish that salat in the middle of the night, تهجد به نافلة لك عسى أن يبعثك ربك مقاما. They look at that maqam al-mahmood and they never neglect tahajjud. What is maqam al-mahmood? Rasulullah was asked. Rasulullah says, whoever spends time in tahajjud will receive maqam al-mahmood. What is maqam al-mahmood, ya Rasulullah? Innahu maqam al-anbiya. It is the position of prophets. It is the position of messengers. It is the position of Rasulullah, of Nuh, of Adam, of Isa, of Musa. They reach this ayah and they look at it with the utmost greed, saying, we would never settle for anything less than this position of maqam al-mahmood. And of course, brothers and sisters, we in our communities, we must engage with the Qur'an. We must bring the Qur'an to reform our communities and rejuvenate our communities. Many of us, we spend the 30 nights of Muharram and the 30 nights of Safar, 68 nights commemorating Imam Hussein. But I tell you, do we know how Imam Hussein spent 51 years of his life? Imam Hussein isn't just the day of Ashura, isn't just confined to the last 10 days of his life. Imam Hussein spent 50 years, 51 years of his life, teaching the Quran at the Masjid of Rasulullah. One day, a Christian man, he was the advisor of Muawiyah, he asks him, he says, why don't you appoint your son Yazid as the Khalifa after you? He says, I am scared of Hussein ibn Ali. Hussein will never give allegiance to my son Yazid. So he said, who's this Hussein? Why are you so afraid of Hussein? I'd like to go and see Hussein, meet him. He says, where can I find Hussein? He says, go to the Masjid of Rasulullah. Take a right, you will see a man sitting on the minbar. And he's engaging with the Quran. And the people listen to him while not blinking an eye. That is Hussein ibn Ali. Many of us, we think of things and we spend time on things that truly will not make any difference in our lives, that will truly not change anything in our day-to-day activities. Some people email me, Sayyid, what was the color of the horse of Imam Hussein? What was the color of the horse of Hazrat Abbas? Was the horse of Ali al-Akbar male or female? If we only gave the same attention to the details within the Qur'an. If we only observed the Qur'an with the same attention, with the same importance. That is why I wish to examine the topic tonight in the following manner. Number one, why was the verse 204 of chapter 7, Surah Al-A'raf, revealed? Number two, what does it mean when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and listen to it? When the Quran is being read, listen to it. And what does it mean when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, pay attention to it? And number three, who was the very first Mufasir of the Holy Quran? Wa sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. First of all, we need to understand why is it that the ulama of Ahlul Bayt and the scholars of the tafsir of Ahlul Bayt give so much importance to the discussion surrounding sababun nuzul, the reason behind the descension of every ayah. It's when we look at sababun nuzul, it's only then when many of the truths can no longer remain hidden. Many of the truths can no longer be changed and tampered with. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in chapter 33, verse 33 says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, innama yuridu Allahu liyudhhiba ankum ar-rijsa ahla al-bayt. وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. Many people might come and tell you that's the definition of Ahlul Bayt speaks of the uncles of Rasulullah, the wives of Rasulullah, and the entire family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We agree. When you say Ahlul Bayt, when you say family of someone, his wife is definitely included. His children are definitely included. So how is it that the followers of Ahlul Bayt say that this ayah only encompasses five individuals? And it leaves out the children of Rasulullah and the wives of Rasulullah and the uncles of Rasulullah. When we go to Sabab al-Nuzul, Tariq al-Kabir for Imam al-Bukhari, says after this ayah was revealed, Rasulullah would stand in front of the door of Fatima for 9 consecutive months after every salah, after the salat of Fajr, after the salat of Dhuhr, after Asr, after Maghrib, after Isha, with a loud voice, and he would say, Assalamu alaykum ya Ahlul Bayt. إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. When we read سبب النزول, this truth can no longer remain hidden. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إنما وليكم الله ورسوله والذين آمنوا الذين يقيمون الصلاة ويؤتون الزكاة وهم راكعون. Yes, indeed, the wali is Allah and Rasulullah and the believers. But when we look at sababun nuzul, of every single mufassir, they say this ayah was revealed to praise one man only. And it spoke of one man only, no one besides Ali ibn Abi Talib. Another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُ أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ. The ayah of ibtihal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, let us invite our men and your men, our women and your women, our children and your children. Many mufassireen can come and discuss many individuals and bring many names, but when you look at Sababun Nuzul and the history surrounding this ayah, you only find five names and there is no six to them. Ali, Muhammad, Fatima, Al-Hasani wal-Husayn. That is why. We, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, must give the utmost attention to understanding why a verse was revealed. When was it revealed? This ayah was revealed according to the Mufassirin when Rasulullah would stand for Salah and he would read the Quran. The Muslimin would read the Quran with him loudly. So he would read Surah Al-Hamd, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. They're standing behind him, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, The ayah was revealed. وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنِ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ When the Quran is being read by Rasulullah or by the Imam, listen to it. وَأَنصِتُوا Pay attention to it. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ And I tell you, sometimes we look at Sababun Nuzul, we understand, okay, this was revealed because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam would read the Quran and the Muslims would read after him loudly. Good. But how do we bring that into our lives? This is where we lack. Some Mufassirin have stated that sometimes Rasulullah would read the Quran. He would say, I have revealed 10 verses. I have received 10 verses, 20 verses, an entire chapter. He would recite it or he would give it to one of his companions. Go ahead and recite those ayat. So the companion would stand to recite the ayat and many people would not be paying attention to them. Some people would be speaking amongst themselves. Some people would be outside. Some people would pay attention but not give their undivided attention. So the ayah speaks to them. So when the Quran is being recited, observe silence. Give it your full attention, your undivided thought. Today, I tell you, brothers and sisters, in almost every one of our communities, almost every one of our communities, we have two types of people. The first type of people who are there when the salah is being done in jama'ah, they're there. When the Quran is being recited, they're there. When the dua kumail is going on, they're there. When the lecture is being given, they're there. They are there from the beginning until the end, especially when the Quran is being recited. And they observe silence and they give the Quran its respect. Then we have the second group of people. When the Quran, when salah is being done, where are they? Outside or inside? Outside. When Quran is being recited, where are they? Outside or inside? Outside. When the lecture is being given, where are they? Outside or inside? Outside. When matam is being done, where are they? Outside or inside? Inside. Allah speaks to this group of people. Don't tell me Sababun Nuzul only relates to me 1,400 years ago. Sababun Nuzul relates to you today. And that is why we ought to take Sababun Nuzul and fix and give remedy to those illnesses within our community. If you see people standing outside, only present in the time of Matam, then you go and you tell them the Quran is either being recited or the Quran is either being observed or explained or the tafsir of the Quran is going on. And your duty is not to stand outside the house of the Quran, but to embrace the house of the Quran and to be within it and to take part in it and to illuminate your minds with it. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنِ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ Listen to it. What does this mean? Does this mean that when the Quran is being read, I just listen quietly? And that's what the Quran is teaching me. The ulama say that we ought to listen to the Quran with al-niyyah, with our niyyah, al-niyyati wal-iqbal. What do I mean? As if you have a niyyah to do any act of worship, just like you have a niyyah to do salah, and you give your undivided attention and niyyah to the salah throughout while the salah is being done. Just like you have a niyyah to do tawaf, and throughout the tawaf you observe that niyyah. Just like you have a niyyah to do the sa'i, and throughout the sa'i you pay attention to that niyyah. Just like you have the niyyah, for example, to pay charity, and you understand the importance of paying that charity, you also have to have niyyah of listening, observing the Quran, this great act of worship throughout its recitation. Because it's an act of worship. Allah is speaking to us in those moments. Sometimes we walk into communities, the Quran is being recited and people are discussing amongst themselves. They're speaking amongst themselves. And sometimes when the reciter is reciting, they're quiet. As soon as he stops to take a breath or flip the page, what do? They speak amongst themselves. Tell him, why you're speaking now? He says, but I was listening when the Quran was being recited. Now there is a moment of silence, so I get to speak to my friend. Imagine you stand in front of someone that is interviewing you for a job. Imagine you stand in front of a president or a prime minister and he's speaking to you. As soon as he stops to get a drink, or as soon as he stops to catch his breath or flip the page, then you start speaking to your friend. I tell you, brothers and sisters, we have not yet understood the position of the Quran, the respect that we ought to give to the Quran. We have yet not understood this. Some of us, we have a relationship with the Quran for 50 years, but we still don't know the importance of the Quran. What do I mean? They say there was a man in one of the holy cities, and he would recite the Quran in every gathering. They call him, he comes and he reads the Quran. Beautiful voice. Every time people would be discussing, he would take out his Quran from his pocket. He would read the Quran. He would not waste his time with anything else, but he had a special relationship with the Quran. He went to Hajj. He came back. When they asked him, Hajji, would you like to come and read the Quran? No. In fact, they say when the Quran was being recited, he would leave the room. He could not hear the Quran. He no longer carried the Quran with him. The relationship had changed 180 degrees. At his youth, up until he was an elderly man, he had the best of relationships with the Quran. Now that he's an old man, after he's gone to Hajj, he has no relationship with the Quran. So a Sayyid in his book, which I read, says, I went to him, I asked him, I said to him, Hajji, what happened? Everyone was zealous of your relationship with the Quran. You had the best of relationships. What happened? Now, not only you don't want to read the Quran, but when the Quran is being recited, you run out of the hall. He says, Sayyid, I don't want to discuss it. Please, tell us. He says, I went to Hajj. I walked out of my residence. He says, I love poetry. So I grabbed the book of poetry. I read it. I loved it. I looked at the cover. It was the poetry of Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Of course, you know Yazid, he had one of the best poets of his time. But what was his poetry? قف على دكة الخمار وسقينا ما قال ربك ويل للذين شربوا بل قال ويل للمصلين. What does he say? He says, give me a glass of wine. Let us enjoy it. Allah did not say wail to those who drink, but he said wail to those who pray. This was Yazid. So he said, I read it. Then I saw the author, Yazid ibn Muawiyah. I said, let me buy the book. So I said, how much? The man said, for example, $5, $10, whatever it may be. He said, I put my hands in my pocket. I wanted to take out the money. I didn't have the money. So I said to him, let me go back to the room. I'll get you your money. He said, you don't need to get your money. There's no need. Give me your Quran. I don't have a Quran in my collection. Give me the Quran. Take the book. So he said, no, but you know, I brought this Quran all the way with me. And you know, I would rather just give you money. He says, look, what's the difference? This Quran is going to go to someone else. They're going to read the Quran, benefit from it. And you want the book of poetry, so let's make an exchange. So he said, it made sense to me. I gave him the Quran and I took the Diwan of poetry of Yazid ibn Muawiyah. He said, from that day, I carry the Quran and it's as if the Quran is telling me, don't carry me. I hear the Quran and it's as if the Quran is telling me, don't listen to me. I want to read the Quran and it's as if the Quran says, I don't want you to read me. I no longer have a relationship with the Quran. Allahu Akbar. You see, brothers and sisters, sometimes we may do certain things in regards to the Quran that will take away the beauty and the sweetness of the Quran away from our lives. One of them is what is being discussed in the ayah. وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنِ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. Listen to it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَنصِتُوا. And pay attention to it. What's the difference between listening and paying attention? Huge difference. One is I may be listening but thinking of many other things. I may be listening but thinking of my business. I may be listening but thinking of my family. I may be listening but thinking of my plans for the rest of the evening. Or sometimes I may be listening without ijabah. What do I mean, ijabah? We say when we do dua and return, we want ijabah. What is ijabah? Ijabah is a response. Ijabah is a reaction. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ. Who is the one that is going to respond to my call? Respond to my dua. React to my cries. Here we are in need of ijabah when we hear the Quran. To respond, to react. It ought to trigger something inside of me. Something is ought to change. I need to incorporate this Quran within my life. Not just read the Quran and move on. Many people, when they want to look for a spouse, they go and they ask their cousins, their parents, his mother, his father. When they want to apply to a university or seek education, they'll go to a counselor. When they want to work and establish a business, they may go and speak to a consultant. When they want to, for example, invest, they go and find a realtor. But we rarely go to the one and only expert, advisor that will never take us astray. Amir al-Mu'mineen, in describing the Holy Quran, says, وَهُوَ الْهَادِيُ الَّذِي لَا يَضِلْ. Indeed, the Quran is the advisor that will never take you astray. It will never give you the wrong advice. It will always take you to your destination safely. Why don't we seek the counsel of the Quran in our lifestyles, in our families, in our businesses, in our relationships? فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا. And pay attention to it. What is the result? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. So that you may see the mercy of Allah. Many of us, we ask, why is it that I have trouble in my business? Why is it that I have trouble within my family? Why is it that I have trouble with my children? Why is it that I have trouble within my marriage? Why is it that I am not blessed in my heart? Why is it that I'm not blessed in my heart, in my mind? It's because the Quran is missing. Allah says, you want mercy? Bring the Quran within your family. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Bring the Quran within your marriage. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Bring the Qur'an within your business. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Bring the Qur'an and disciplining your children. What is the result? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. The Qur'an, brothers and sisters, should not only be observed as a ritual. When somebody's traveling, we hold the Qur'an, we kiss the Qur'an, we walk underneath the Qur'an. When somebody dies, we come and recite Surah Yasin. When somebody's getting married before the Aqd, we open the Qur'an in front of their eyes, in front of the time of their Aqd. The Qur'an is not just for ritual practices. The Qur'an is for me to incorporate it in my life, to take lessons from it. And I tell you, brothers and sisters, the reason why the world today has not come to embrace the Qur'an is not because of the Qur'an. The reason is how we have portrayed the Qur'an to the public. If the people aren't here to take the Qur'an, to observe the Qur'an, to study the Qur'an, it's not because of the Qur'an. It's because of our shortcomings in representing the Qur'an to the public. I said this last year, and I have to say it again. We have many masajid, many Husayniyat, many Imam Bargas. But yet we still don't have one single Dar al-Quran. An area where we translate the Quran, we publish the Quran, we write an entire tafsir of the Quran in the English language according to the teachings of Ahl al-Bayt. Today, if universities and colleges and professors want to teach the Qur'an or learn the Qur'an, where do they go? Where do they go? Do they go to the Ahlul Bayt? No. The knowledge of the tafsir of the Ahlul Bayt isn't available in the English language. An entire tafsir of the Qur'an according to Ja'far ibn Muhammad, according to Muhammad al-Baqir, according to Ja'far al-Sadiq, according to Imam al-Ridha, according to Amir al-Mu'mineen is not available today. And if we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower onto us from His rahmah, from His mercy, then we ought to give our attention to the Qur'an. We ought to be amongst those who establish an institution dedicated to the Qur'an. The Qur'an that is being taught by Al-Muhammad, they are the ones that understood the Qur'an. They are the ones that observe the Qur'an. But yet their followers today have the greatest shortcomings when it comes to addressing the Qur'an. Number three, many people ask, when did the tafsir of the Qur'an begin? Was it 10 years after Rasulullah? Was it 20 years after Rasulullah? Was it a century after Rasulullah? And you recall last year we spoke of the five different methodologies of tafsir. This year, we're going to discuss who was the very first mufassir of the Qur'an. If you look at the books, they'll tell you the first mufassirin were the elite of the Sahaba. Abdullah ibn Abbas, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Abdullah ibn Umar. Sometimes they mention the name of Ali ibn Abi Talib. They were the first set of the elite of the mufassirin of the Qur'an. But I tell you, there are 205 ahadith of Rasulullah strictly in the area of tafsir al-Qur'an. Therefore, Rasulullah was the pioneer and the founder of the science of tafsir al-Qur'an. And we have many ahadith where when it comes to tafsir of the Qur'an, they're initiated by Rasulullah. The very first that we ought to examine is the hadith of Rasulullah that says, أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. I was given the Qur'an and similar to it in explanation, similar to it in tafsir. I didn't receive the Qur'an without the explanation, but I received it with its entire tafsir and ta'wil. And that is how it was revealed to me. What are some of the examples of the tafsir of the Quran of Rasulullah. Chapter 108, verse number 2. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. Fasalli li rabbika wanhar. If you look at the translation, it says, we have given you the kawthar, and return, you ought to pray and sacrifice. But they asked Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, how would we sacrifice? What is this nahr? Rasulullah says, indeed, it's not the nahr and the sacrifice of animals, but it is the nahr of ourselves in the time of salah. Observe this. He says, it's when you raise your hands all the way to your ears and you say, Allahu Akbar. That is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying within chapter 108, verse number 2. Who would have been able to explain this to you without Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And have you ever thought, brothers and sisters, why is it that in the time of salah, we ought to observe our takbirat fully? We raise our hands in every takbir, after ruku', after sujood, in every movement. Allahu Akbar, we go to ruku'. Allahu Akbar, we begin our salah. Allahu Akbar, we get up from sujood. We go back to sujood. Why? It's because without the Allahu Akbar, sometimes our salah turns into gymnastics. Yeah? Allahu Akbar. But this, you stop, you pause for a moment, you separate the standing from ruku' and the ruku' from sujood, and that's only when you stand firm and fully and you say Allahu Akbar. One day, one of the greatest companions of Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad ibn al-Sadiq by the name of Hamad bin Isa comes to him. As soon as he walks in, Imam al-Sadiq says to him, Ya Hamad, atuhsinu salah? Do you know how to pray? Hamad was a mujtahid. Hamad was a mujtahid. In fact, he was one of the greatest companions of Imam al-Sadiq, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, and Imam al-Rida. Imam Musa ibn Ja'far did a special dua for Hamad. He said, Oh Allah, grant Hamad 50 hajj that are accepted. Allahu Akbar. 50 hajj that are accepted. And at the 51st hajj, Hamad drowned in Juhfa. So today he is known as Hamad bin Isa Ghariq Juhfa, one of the greatest companions of Imam al-Sadiq. Imam asks him, Ya Hamad, atuhsinu salah? Do you know how to pray? So Hamad says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, Inni udriku kitab Hariz ibn Abdullah al-Sijistani. I have memorized the book of Hurayz Ibn Abdullah al-Sijistani, one of the other companions who was from Sistan. I've memorized it, and his book spoke of salah. So the Imam says, fair enough, stand up and pray. Stand up. So he stood and he prayed. When he finished, the Imam looked at him and he said to him, Ya Hamad, la tuhsinu salah. Ya Hamad, you don't know how to pray. You know what the Imam then said? He says, قَبُحَ أَنَّ الرَّجُلَ مِنْكُمْ يَأْتِي عَلَيْهِ الْخَمْسِينَ وَالسِّتِينَ وَالسَّبْعِينَ وَلَا يُدْرِكُ الصَّلَاةِ وَلَا يُحْسِنُ الصَّلَاةِ. He says, it's shameful that amongst you there are individuals who they become 50 and 60 and 70 and they still do not know how to perform salah. Allahu Akbar. Hamad says, فَشَعَرْتُ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ بِالذُّلِّ. I felt so little, humiliated, embarrassed. So then the Imam says, Ya Hamad, I am going to stand and perform the salah. Look at me. Look at the love of the companions. Look at the love of the Imam for his companions. Look at the special bond. Look at the special relationship. He stands and prays in front of him so that he witnesses the salah. He perfects the salah. And amongst, this is in Kafi, go and read the hadith. Amongst the most important areas where Hamad bin Isa then focuses on when explaining the salah of Imam al-Sadiq was this takbir. That when he stood, he first stood and he paused and he was firm. Then he said, Allahu Akbar. Then when he read Surah Al-Hamd and the other surah, he paused, he was firm. Then he said, Allahu Akbar. Then he went to ruku'. When he stood, he was again firm. Then he said, Allahu Akbar. He went to ruku', then he went to sujood. Between his sujood, he was firm. He stood. The hadith says nothing of his body would move unless it was moved by the wind. He didn't move his arm and, you know, looking at his fingers and, you know, playing with his beard. A man comes. He prays in front of Rasulullah and the whole time he's going like this. Rasulullah says, لَوْ خَشَعَ قَلْبُهُ لَخَشَعَ الْجَوَارِحُ. If his heart was with the salah, then all of his existence would be with the salah. If his heart had observed khushu', then his hand would also observe khushu'. His eyes would also observe khushu'. So one area, as we find the tafsir of Rasulullah in regards to salah. Another area, we find the tafsir of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam into the day-to-day affairs of the people. Sinan ibn Anas, one of his companions, he had sold a small village. Within the small village, there was a house. Within the house, there was a palm tree. Samar ibn Jundub. And Samar ibn Jundub sold this house, but he said, I will keep this palm tree for myself. I'm not selling the palm tree. So this man, he purchased the palm tree. He purchased the home, and he thought that this man would only come, you know, at a specific time, a specific hour, then he would knock, seek permission. But apparently this man wasn't with it. So he would come in the middle of the night, barging into their home. Why are you here? He says, I'm here to water my palm tree. Says, but why don't you come in the morning? Says, no, this is the time. This is my palm tree. It belongs to me. Then, for example, at the time of noon, the woman, the children, they're out in the garden. He barges in without asking for permission. Again, this man says to him, why don't you, Samara, why don't you ask for permission before you enter? He says, but it's my palm tree. I don't need to ask you for permission. He comes while, for example, this man was resting with his wife or with his daughters. There is no hijab. He comes in running. This man of the Ansar, he was very upset. He went to Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah, Samara, I've told him to choose a specific time. He doesn't. I've told him to knock. He doesn't. I've told him, listen, sell me the palm tree. He doesn't. How can I deal with him, Ya Rasulullah? Rasulullah said, call him. They brought Samara. Samara sat in front of him. Rasulullah said, Ya Samara, sell me the palm tree. Rasulullah says to him, sell me the palm tree. He says, Ya Rasulullah, it's not for sale. It's okay. Samara, give me this palm tree and I shall give you a palm tree in paradise. And I am Rasulullah. So I don't want a palm tree in paradise. I want this palm tree. Rasulullah said, okay, designate a time for them, a specific time. And that specific time, you go and you water your palm tree, you take its dates. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I don't want to do that. Rasulullah then says, iqla'uha, remove it, uproot it. وَجْعَلُوهَا فِي وَرْمُوهَا فِي وَجْهِهِ and throw it in his face. إِنَّهُ لَا ضَرَرَ وَلَا ضِرَارَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. For there is no harm in the religion of Islam. لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينِ. There is no compulsion. There is no hardship. There is no such thing as you bringing harm and difficulty to someone's life in the name of Islam, that this palm tree belongs to me. He cannot refrain me from visiting my own palm tree. This is how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dealt with the tafsir of the Quran when it came to resolving social issues. Similarly, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam established an understanding amongst his sahaba in his present time and for the future. Allahu Akbar. Look at the tafsir of surah number 47, ayah number 47, ayah number 36. Surah Muhammad. Surah Muhammad. Inna Allaha huwa al-ghani wa antum al-fuqara. Allah is the rich and you are impoverished. So the Arabs, they came to him, Ya Rasulullah, what does Allah mean? He is the rich, we are the impoverished, we have money. He thinks we're poor? Wallahi, I tell you, some people, yes, they think they have so much money, they can never be impoverished. One day, a woman went to a jeweler in Isfahan. This is a very famous story. So she told him, give me some sadaqah. I need to pay my rent. So he looked at his box. He didn't find any change. So he said to her, go and come back. I don't have any change now. She says, why you want to give me change? Give me large bills. Give me money. You have all this jewelry. You're the biggest jeweler in town. Why do you want to give me small change? So he says to her, come on, get out of here. She said, are you not afraid that one day you will be like me? So he looked at her and he said, how? She said, Allah. Allah can take away your wealth. He says, even Allah, if he wanted to take my wealth, it would take him 60 years. Apparently, the man had a lot of money. He says, even if Allah wanted to start taking my wealth from this moment onwards, it would take him 60 years. She went out of the store. The guards of the Shah came in the bazaar. They said, close down the bazaar. What's going on? Said, there's a fugitive. He's hiding in one of the stores here. And the order of the king is that whoever we find this fugitive with, all of his wealth will be confiscated. So they read the order. He said, you come to my store? I am a personal friend of the queen. She was here in my store a couple of days ago. Get lost. So they went and they searched every other store in the bazaar. They couldn't find the fugitive. They said, look, I mean, if we would have found him somewhere else, you're right, but we couldn't find him, so we have to search your store. And guess what? They found the fugitive in his store. It was his own cousin. They stripped him from everything, including his shoes. Let us not be arrogant with Allah. Let us not be arrogant with the ni'am of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, I even want to say this, if you have 10 years, 15 years, 5 years, 30 years left in your life dedicated to Allah. This life is short, wallah. Tomorrow, they'll come to you and they'll say you have to pick up and leave. You have to move on. They say, but I didn't have time. Give me a moment. Give me a day. Let me sponsor an orphan. They tell you what? اليوم عمل بلا حساب وغدا حساب بلا عمل. Today, you have the ability to do, to act without حساب. But from now on, it's only حساب without عمل. The Quran says, we plead, we beg, Rabbi arji'ni. Oh Allah, return me. لِكَيْ أَعْمَلَ صَالِحًا. So I do one good deed. Now you have moved on. You had your chance. It's too late now. It's only meaningful if we dedicate the rest of our lives to Allah, to Rasulullah, to the Qur'an, to the Ahlul Bayt, and specifically to the most generous, to the most capable, Al-Imam Al-Husayn. You can never go wrong with dealing with him. You can never go wrong when having a relationship with him. Look at what Allah has chosen for him. Look at what Allah has given him. For thousands of years, they amputated the hands of his zuwar. They amputated their legs. They created ISIS, Al-Qaeda, the army of the Sahaba. Millions of dollars pump out of the oil to destroy the Zaireen of this man. But Allah says, never. He belongs to me. He is my cause. He is my beloved. I will raise Hussein and raise him and raise him until it will astonish the entire world. Hatta la yabqa nabiyun mursal. Ziyara al-jama' al-kabira. Wala siddiqun, wala shaheedun, wala alimun. Unless, until there is every prophet, even prophets will be surprised. Every siddiq, Yusuf was a siddiq, will be surprised. Every shaheed will be surprised of the position given to Hussein. Indeed, it's only meaningful if we dedicate our life, the rest of our life to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and Allah is the rich, he is the ghani, wa antum al-fuqara. Al-Tabari says the Arabs came to him, Ya Rasulallah, how is it that Allah is the rich and we are impoverished? We have money. How is Allah going to take our money from us? Rasulullah says to them, you are indeed arrogant with this faith given to you. So Allah is going to impoverish you with taking away the iman from you. What does Imam Hussein say? Whoever has you does not need anything else. And whoever has everything besides you is impoverished. مَاذَا فَقَدَ مَنْ وَجَدَكْ وَمَاذَا وَجَدَ مَنْ فَقَدَكْ. What has he found, the man who hasn't found you? And what is his loss if he has you and doesn't have anything else? So Rasulullah says, oh, you Arabs, Allah will take away the iman from you, and that is how you will be impoverished, because you are arrogant with this faith. You are arrogant with this iman. Al-Tabari says, they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, how so? So he says, Allah will pass this faith to this man and his followers. And he put his hand on the feet of Salman al-Muhammad. Allah will take it from you and give it to them. Allah will take it from you and give it to Hadha wa qawmih and his people. Then he says, Wallahi alladhi nafsi biyadih. I swear, in the name of the man, of the one who holds my soul, Allah, some of the people of force will chase iman even if it was in the seventh heaven. And I tell you, those Arabs, they could not hear Rasulullah saying such a thing. Allah would take Islam, give it to this Persian who was impoverished. They made fun of the way he speaks. They made fun of the way he eats. They made fun of the way he lived. Salman. But Rasulullah at that time gave them the statement that Allah will give iman to them. And look at the world today. Look at this impoverished nation, the cradle of Islam, the birthplace of Islam. It's impoverished with iman. Where is the iman there? Where is the taqwa? Where is the true essence of Islam? Huh? It's been taken away from them. But let us, brothers and sisters, understand that similarly Allah has blessed us with the Quran, with the Ahlul Bayt, with Hussein. Let us not do that which they did so that we would become impoverished too. Allah says, "In shakartum la azidannakum." If you were to be thankful, I will increase. Wa in kafartum. But if you are not thankful with my blessings, فَإِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. Let us be thankful for the ni'mah of iman. Let us be thankful for the ni'mah of Islam. Let us be thankful for the ni'mah of the Qur'an. Let us be thankful for the ni'mah of the Ahlul Bayt. I was in a community a couple of days ago. I asked them, how many of you are about to go and visit Imam Hussein in Arba'een? I didn't see a single hand. I said to them, you know what? Imam As-Sadiq would ask his companions, which one of you have visited Imam Hussein recently? And they say, we visited him last month or 2 months ago. From where? From where? Medina. All the way to Iraq. They wouldn't have airplanes. It would take them a long time. Imam As-Sadiq would become upset and he would say, Zur al-Hussein. Go and visit Hussein. إِنَّ زِيَارَتَهُ وَاجِبَةٌ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ مَنْ قَالَ بِإِمَامَتِهِ. His ziyara is indeed wajib upon every man and woman that says of his, declares of his imama. Yes, one way to thank Hussein is to go to him. To walk to him. To spend your money. To stand in front of his shrine. To tell him, I come to you from a very long distance. I seek nothing but your love. Your love is what has motivated me to be here. I do this so that on the day of judgment, I look at your mother Fatima and I said, I was amongst those za'areen of your son Hussein. I look at your grandfather Rasulullah and I say, the love of your grandson Hussein drove me to you. And more importantly, you hold and uplift the standards and the principles of Hussein wherever you are. Don't forget that. If you're a Husseini, you are the ambassador of Hussein. Let me reflect at my own self, at my own akhlaq, at my own ideology, at my own attitude, and ask myself, am I amongst those who, if were in the present in the day of Ashura, and Imam Hussein turned off the candle, they were 1,200. He turned it on, they were 72. Am I amongst them? Am I amongst the 72? Or am I amongst the other ones standing on the other side? The last moments, you heard the story of Imam Hussein. Umar ibn Sa'd was weeping. He was weeping. 12 men went to execute Imam Hussein. When they see the light in his face, they could not bear it. They turn around, they run away. So we cannot. A man who has been stabbed hundreds of times, bleeding from every angle, yet the historians say, لَمْ نَرَ رَجُلًا أَصْبَحَ وَجْهًا مِنْهُ, with a beautiful face like Hussein ibn Ali. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam indeed was the very first mufassir of the Quran, the very first man to begin the exegete of the Quran. But did it stop there? I said 205 or 204 ahadith of tafsir. How did it continue? Where did Rasulullah point us to after him? If you are a Muslim, I urge you, go and read your books. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, Aliyun ma'al Qur'an wal Qur'anu ma'al. Lan yaftariqa hatta yarida alayya al-hawd. Ali is with the Qur'an and the Qur'an is with Ali. And they are inseparable until the day of the hawd, the day where you meet me on the river of Kawthar. Ali a'lamu an-nas bil kitab was-sunnah. Ali is the most learned when it comes to the Quran. Ali is the most learned when it comes to the sunnah. What does he say? He says, saluni qabla an tafquduni. Ask me before you lose me. Fa anni wallah أَعْلَمُ بِالْقُرْآنِ I swear to you, by Allah that holds my soul, I am the most learned when it comes to the Qur'an. And I am in greater of knowledge than every man that ever claims to have the knowledge of the Qur'an. Ask me of a verse and I tell you when it was revealed, why it was revealed, at what time it was revealed. And I will tell you if it's ta'wil, and I will tell you if it's tafsir. And Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Mawla al-Muwahideen was busy with the Qur'an after the demise of Rasulullah. For 6 months he did not wear the clothes that drove him out of his residence. For six months, he sat at home. He never left his residence, unless the times where he was forced to leave his residence. And he was busy writing the Qur'an. Look at the book of Ihtijaj. He says he wrote the entire Qur'an, the tafsir of the Qur'an, and the ta'wil of the Qur'an, and why it was revealed, and when it was revealed. Then he took it inside the Masjid of Rasulullah. And he told them, I have now completed the Qur'an. So they came, they looked. وَرَأَوْ فِيهَا أَشْيَاءٌ وَأَسْمَاءٌ There they found some things and some names. Then they said, يَا أَبَا الْحَسَنْ نَحْنُ فِي غِنًا مِنْهِ يَا أَبَا الْحَسَنْ, we don't need this. أَرْجِعْ, return it back to your home. What did Imam say to them? You will never see it. And that is why one of the signs of the Imam, a true Imam, is that he carries the Quran of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he carries the sword of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he has the Amama of Rasulullah. And where is that? Where is that Quran today? Where is that Dhul-Faqar today? Tomorrow, when you read Dua and Nudba, what do you tell him? You tell him, أَيْنَ الطَّالِبُ بِدَمِ الْمَقْتُولِ بِكَرْبَلَىٰ Oh, our Imam, it's been too long. Look at your followers everywhere. Look at the enemies. We are in need of you, oh, our Imam. Our entire existence calls for you, Ya Imam. Aina talibu bidamil maqtul bikarbala. Allahu Akbar. He will come back, then he will go to the shrine of his grandfather, Aba Abdullah. He will stand in front of the shrine of his grandfather, Imam Hussein, and he would say to him, لَأَبْكِيَنَّ عَلَيْكَ صَبَاحًا وَمَسَاءً وَلَأَنْدُبَنَّكَ بدل الدموع دما Oh my grandfather, Ya Aba Abdullah, I cry for you in the day and the night. And I shed tears of blood for you, Ya Aba Abdullah. Then the Imam responds to him and he says, وَعَلَيْكَ السَّلَامِ يَا وَلَدِي مَا أَبْطَأَكَ عَنِّي Oh my son, wa alayka salam, what took you so long? Allahu Akbar. You know the reason why they have a red flag on the dome of Imam Hussein? It's because the Arabs, if somebody has died and they haven't taken his vengeance and he died as mazloom, they put a red flag on his grave saying that one day someone will come and take his vengeance. The Imam says, Oh my son, what took you so long? Allahu Akbar. Then the Imam goes to the grave of his grandfather. He opens the side of the grave. He takes out a white khurqa cloth.
he raises it to the sky. He says, oh man, oh people, if the elders had a crime, what is the crime of this 6-month-old infant? Yes, the Imam, the very first moments of his reappearance, engages the people with his grandfather and the masa'ib of his grandfather, Al-Imam Al-Husayn. Allahu Akbar. But we tell him, Ya Sayyidi wa Ya Mawlai. I am sure that you hear the masa'ib of Ali Al-Akbar, of your uncle Abbas, and you hear the masa'ib of your grandfather Hussein, and there is nothing a greater tragedy than that. But how can you bear listening that after Hussein was sleeping on the sands of Karbala, they came to the tents of the women and children, and your Amma Zainab was amongst them, running from one tent to another. Allahu Akbar. How can you bear, Ya Sahib al-Zaman, hearing that they took the hijab of the woman of Al Muhammad away from them, and they took them as captives, slaves, from one city to another? Ya Sahib al-Amr. And do you recall when she put all the women and children on the back of the horses and the camels? Then she looked at the Euphrates. There is no man to come and help her, so that she goes and sits on the saddle. Then she says, As-salamu alayk, Ya Rasul Allah, Salla alayka maliku sama, Hada Husaynun, Mukhadzabun bid-dima, Maslub al-imamati wal-rida. Allahu Akbar. Then they went from Karbala until they reached the city of Rasulullah. Allahu Akbar. They left with Hussein, they left with Abbas, they left with Ali and Akbar, with Qasim. But how did they return? He came and stood in front of the grave of Rasulullah, and he said, Ya Ahla Yathrib, la muqama lakum biha, qutil al-Husayn fa'admu'i midraru. Oh, the people of Medina, you will not bear this news. What is the news? Qutil al-Husayn fa'admu'i midraru. Where is he? Allahu Akbar. Al-jismu minhu muqatta'un bi-Karbala. His body is left in Karbala. Where is his head? وَالرَّأْسْ فَوْقَ الرَّمْحِ يُدَارُ. فَإِلَيْكَ يَا رَبِّي نصبت وجهي، وإليك يا ربي مددت يدي، فبعزتك استجب لي دعائي، وبلغني مناي، ولا تقطع من فضلك أملي ورجائي. يا سريع الرضا، يا سريع الرضا، الرضا اغفر لمن لا يملك إلا الرجاء، وسلاحه البكاء. يا سابغ النعم، يا دافع النقم، يا نور المستوحشين في الظلام،
Ya Aliman la yu'allam Salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad Waf'al bima anta ahluh Wa la taf'al bima ana ahluh Brothers, sisters, we are here to commemorate the martyrdom of Mariyad Karbala. Allahu Akbar. While the grave of his grandfather, of his father Hussein, his grandfather in Najaf, are flocking with the mu'mineen. Let us go to Medina. A single light by the grave of Zain al-Abidin. A single visitor to the grave of Zain al-Abidin. Allahu Akbar, he is the true mazloom. We tell him, Ya Sayyidana, Ya Mawlana, Inna tawajjahna wa istashfa'na wa tawassalna bika ila Allah وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله يا وجيها عند الله We tell him, Ya Ali ibn al-Husayn, we ask you in the name of your father Hussein, your brothers, in the name of your aunt Zainab, to take a glance at us today, at this gathering today of mercy and compassion. All of us together, brothers, wallah, they are babul hawa'ij. Ya wajihan inda Allah. اشفع لنا عند الله نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم It's Thursday night, the time of dua after the majlis of Hussein. 10 times we call on to him, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. Allahumma inna nas'aluka bi Muhammadin wa Aliyin wa Fatima wal Hasani wal Husayn wa tis'ati al ma'sumin min dhurriyyati al Husayn. O Allah, every man, woman present in this gathering with a sin, forgive our sins. Conceal our sins. O Allah, shower onto the graves of the mu'mineen and mu'minat from your compassion. O Allah, accept this humble aza from us. O Allah, give us the greatest of reward which you have given for the mu'azzin of Al Muhammad. O Allah, honor us with the life of the Quran. Allow the Quran to be our interceder in the day of judgment. O Allah, we ask you in the name of Hussein and the companions of Hussein to grant us the visitation of Hussein, the shafa'ah of Hussein. Three times, brothers and sisters, together, Ilahi al-Tawbah, Ilahi al-Tawbah, Ilahi al-Tawbah. Three times, Ya Ghaffar al-Dhunub. Three times, Ya Sattar al-Uyub. Ya Sattar al-Uyub. يا ستار العيوب اللهم عجل ثم عجل لمولانا الفرج والعافية والنصر واجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والعلماء والشهداء وخدمة الحسين نهدي جميعا ثواب سورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.